If you do good things with the money and you can make the money, you don't, you're being selfish. And what happens is we never comprehend that we've never been the fruit. We've always been the tree. No. The things I learned in football make me money now. So yes, the love of money and only money is a problem. But if you love the people and they are the end and that's a means, it's the right thing to do. But the ego shows up to protect the identity, good and bad. And you can actually be too close. So when I get to that point, the reality is I feel like you're robbing the world of a gift of you. Let me ask you a question. You know what to do, right? Yeah. Not being done, right? Yeah. Okay. The person who has what you want, would they make the same excuse to stop right now? He also at the end talks about wisdom and experience.
Yeah.
And experience and information, intellectual stuff, it's great, but it's not wisdom because wisdom must be seasoned. Here's a funny thing. People say, I'm not perfect. But the moment you show them an area of imperfection, they fight it. But take heart because I have overcome it. And so when we talk about accepting Christ into your heart, he now lives in you. So he's overcome the world. So if he's in you, he's got you.
Never short stopping, now I'm winning like I'm Jada. Steady through the rigor, yeah, I'm getting bigger. Fighting in them trenches, now I'm making seven figures like.
So my guest today grew up a black adopted boy in a poor white family to beat the odds to become the man he is today. NFL athlete, American Ninja Warrior, international speaker, has also been featured in Success magazine, Netflix, and Amazon Prime. And I'm excited about this conversation. I was just joking with him beforehand. I said, if you took in his bio, replaced the fact that he was adopted into a foster family, teen parent, NFL, we practically have the same bio. So, Anthony Trucks, what a perfect name for a football player.
Right, worked out, man. I'm not gonna complain. I played linebacker too, so it's a real good name for linebacker of all names.
So the conversations has got to come up, man. You know, what was that freak injury in your shoulder? Because you played one preseason game, according to your bio, one preseason game, and was it the right shoulder, left shoulder? What was it during a play or practice?
It was third year, first preseason game. So like the first, it's like my playing with the Steelers. So I have two vested seasons, we'll call it, for having played like the couple years before. But I was in the first game against the Philadelphia Eagles, playing with the Pittsburgh Steelers in 2008. And I went in like second half, and there was something more like, it's a toss play. If anybody knows football, a toss play, linebacker, you turn and you run. The guy next to me didn't turn and run. So I ended up turning and running. I was looking at the ball and trip over him. I go down. The guy who's assigned to block me puts a foot in the air and jumps in the air like Superman, lands on my back, tears my shoulder.
Oh, no.
Time, like, you, in the middle of a game, it's adrenaline. Like, you know, you don't notice. So I play the rest of the game, and even like, your body's beat up. Yeah, you didn't even think about it. And then the next morning, I go to, like, lift, like, my laptop bag up, and I can't move my arm. So, yeah, end of the season, and then eventually end of the career. All my teammates went on that year to win the Super Bowl, and I got to sit there and watch.
Was that with which year was that? As 08, 09, that was
That was when James Harrison ran the longest interception back for a touchdown against the Cardinals.
Well, we know we got to put that in the B-roll right now there. So, I mean, I'm living vicariously through you right now. If you don't mind us revisiting that part of your life,
yeah.
You know, take us through a typical NFL athlete today, because I'm always intrigued about how people are so committed to a sport and an endeavor. People love to see the game on Sundays, but they may not want to do what a typical NFL athlete does on a daily basis.
It's not sexy. There's no allure. It's not like we're sitting on yachts and boats all day, dude. I mean, let's talk about in season. So in season, I'm in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So it's snowy outside. So you're not even going outside. Typically you get up at, I don't know, I got up like 5:30. Got to get to the facility by like 6:30, catch a workout. Your workout's about an hour long, and it's, you know, it's not even like you want to be there. It's just maintenance workout because your body's beat up from practice most of the time. So you get there, it's your workout, you get done, you got to go get some food real quick, take a quick shower, go up to the room where we have the whole entire team. So it's team meeting. Coach Tom was there with the Steelers. So team meeting, after the team meeting, you end up having a special teams meeting. So it's like hour and another hour. So we're probably close to like 8:39 now. Then you have from the special teams meeting, you go to the defensive team meeting, another hour. So now we're like closer to 10:30. Then you have your linebacker meeting, and that's just like your individual, you know, position meeting. It takes till about 11:30, 12:00. Now, just so you know, these meetings aren't like hanging out, chatting, talking. It's a dark room. It's filmed. You're pretty much getting yelled at. Silent movies, just over. Fast forward, reverse. You suck. Good job. You suck. Right. Nonstop. And then you go from there. It's like, all right, go down and grab lunch, 12 to like 1. And like 1 o'clock, it's like, hey, get dressed, head to practice. Practice, you start at like 1:30, let's say 2. And then from 2 until like 4:30, then you get done. You come in, you eat again. After you get done eating, you obviously take a shower. You go watch more film from practice. So, you know, then like 6, 7 o'clock hits, you go get, you know, some food from wherever you get food. Sometimes it's there. Sometimes you get on your own. And you got to get back in bed by like 9 or 10. So you pretty much get like 2 hours to yourself at the end of the night. And it happens again and again and again. And then on Saturdays, you prepare for the game on Sunday. Sunday happens. You might get that Tuesday day off. But if you're a good team, Tuesday's not a day off. The NFL is like, it's optional. And the team's like, but it's optional for us to keep you on the team. You know, so it's that whole role, man. But that's an in-season schedule of how we rock our lives.
How much different was it than the college life? When you were at Oregon, and by the way, my number in high school was 84.
Oh, yeah?
So it was the craziest thing, man. It's like, you know, it's...
That was a dumb number for me to have as a linebacker in college. You know what it was? I had this weird thing with, like, odd numbers. I hated them. So what happened was I went to college, and they had, like, 2 or 3 even numbers. And I was like, I don't want, you know, the even number. I was super low. So I was like, give me whatever you got. And it was, like, 84. So I was like, all right. So I took 84 as a linebacker. And so for years, people were like, man, change it. I'm like, nah. So everybody get this big buff-looking receiver with my linebacker with this, you know, collar out the back. It looked so weird, but I balled out. I was on billboards and everything. But, you know, college was not much different except for when I was in college. It was just school, right? So you had less time to do film and everything. But we had, you know, I had a son too. So from sophomore year on, it was pretty much, I had classes where most guys are sleeping in. You know, I had classes like 7 a.m. start. So I'm up early, I'm to practice or to school. Then I get done with school, I would come home, I would take care of my son. My wife, her fiance at the time, went to her stuff. She gets it back, I'm off to get the workout in for the day. Then all the same stuff, meetings. The worst part was after practice, you don't go home. Typically, you got to go to study hall. So I'm in study hall and I'm doing my study hall thing. You know, she's like, but when are you going to get home so you can come take care of this baby? Then she'd take night classes because she couldn't do it during the day.
Wow.
And it was crazy, man. It was like good 2.5 years of just running that whole gamut. But college is a little bit, I think the off season is a little bit different because where in the NFL, you have time and money. You can go places. College, it's like you got time and no money. So you just stick around town, catch workouts. We go to the dollar movie theaters all the time and sneak in for like multiple movies. But that was, yeah, dude, it's just like you don't have a life outside of the sport.
How do you feel now that the NCAA has allowed for income to be earned by college players?
I think it's different from before because before was like a lot of guys, like you don't have, for example, not everybody has an opportunity to make money signing, you know, jerseys and selling autographs. So at first it's like, only the special guys get it. Why even worry about it? But the game's changed now. Like you could be a guy that's weird and watches anime and all of a sudden you get some manga can like give you some money to put their stuff on your social media. Don't matter how nerdy or how cool or whatever it is, like anybody has an opportunity now to develop a brand and that brand can be monetized in way more ways than autographs. And so it's really cool that the NCAA kind of caught up to the speed of society.
Yeah.
It was super outdated. And I think honestly, it's going to benefit these schools because they're going to have opportunities. They do it right to help these kids get brand deals that then help the school at the bigger level if they're smart. So that's, I know where they were fighting before. I think it's going to be better for everybody involved right now.
Because I remember that kicker from Central Florida. He's got a YouTube channel called Destroy. Destroy.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. But they said, listen, you got a YouTube channel. It's either YouTube or you'd be a kicker. A kicker.
I know this guy. It's a black guy, right?
Yeah, exactly. And he's fast. He's quick. He's always catching balls. And yeah.
He does like funny stuff. Like, I think he did some stuff with Cheetah. What's his name? Tyreek Hill. I think he did some stuff with him, if I'm not mistaken. Too. Yeah.
I see. Destroy one. And so he today would be able to stay in college and probably make it to the NFL. But he's killing it right now. Millions of people following him on social media and monetizing YouTube. You know, Trucks, let's go back to your childhood here, because by the way, how many guys are already exhausted just listening to his daily NFL day in college day? It's like, wow.
So that's a little, that's like a percent of my life, if that.
Right. So talk to us about your childhood. Young black kid adopted into the foster system and then adopted into a poor white family. Talk to us about that. Talk to us about that experience.
Yeah, man, I was born to a white mom and no dad present. And so it was just weird growing up. You know, I can recall the moment of being given away, but I also at the same time had 3 siblings that are like year to year to year. You know, they have like Irish twins, like back to back. These are like Irish quadruplets, I guess, like just back to back to back. I was the only one with a different dad, though. So, like, it was me, and then my other real dad's gone, and my mom's white, and my birth certificate says my dad's last name's O'Byrne, which is Irish. So something went wrong, or she's lying. The latter, you know?
Well, we can, it's obvious. I mean, just look at you, right?
Yeah. Most people have no idea I'm mixed. They don't have no idea I'm half white. But I found out later my real dad's, like, full Nigerian, like, fresh off the boat from Nigeria, like, heavy accent, you know? So that's like at 21 I found him in college. But yeah, no, so giving away, man, I went to this whole heinous foster care world, because in that world, you're a paycheck. So as long as you don't die, you know, they get a paycheck, and there's no social media, there's no videos, there's no reports.
No accountability.
Yeah, it's nothing. On top of that, we all as kids want to go back to our real parents. So it's common for us to create stories or act out in ways that make us think, like, the logic is, well, if I'm so bad, they'll send me home. No, they won't. So you just act up and you do things, and they can't determine, is this really happening or is the kid making up lies? So, like, I'm putting chicken coops and forced to chase chickens to earn meals. I'm putting shopping carts pushed down hills. I'm made to lick the bottom of people's shoes. Like, and you report that and nobody's listening to you. And on top of that, it's overworked caseload. So, dude, from like 83 to 86, like, that's when I was that age, but 86 to, like, shoot, the next 4 or 5 years, bro, it was crazy, like 91. And I ended up in a family at 6 years old, which is my current family. And it was very poor, all white. My first dad in that family was like a drunk. So I did experience some kind of stuff early on, but it was always this journey of, like, who in the world am I? Where do I fit? I'm the only black kid in all white elementary school. And for the most part, everybody's cool, but there's those kids that make me have black moments. It's just gonna happen. Yeah. And but here's the ticket thing. It was these two little twin white boys that used to call me a bunch of words. I used to beat the hell out of them, and they kept doing it. It was so weird. Like, just kept going.
It all learned.
So many fights. It's nuts. That my childhood was crazy, man.
I mean, you and I growing up, man, I mean, today it's called bullying. Yeah. When we were growing up, it's called growing up, you know?
Just toughen them up, man. It toughened me up. I toughened them up, too. I had to, because there's no way to get it. But, yeah, dude, it's one of those things where I think that we rob kids of their hardships. But I don't think that all the hardships were necessary. I don't think I needed to experience all that. But I do know that it did strengthen me to levels that most people can't touch right now.
How do you counsel your kids? How do you coach your kids right now? If they come across bullies like that you faced in school, would there be any difference of how you coach them, how to handle them versus how you handled them growing up?
A little bit. I was one that was like, so as a kid, people would test me and I was quick to throw blows. Like, I was the first one with a punch, right? And it was worse as I got put into karate early on. So they taught me how to do it properly, which was not good for anybody. I was like in 16 fights my sixth grade year, which really is nuts. But now I'm real big on telling my kids, like, first off, a lot of these kids at home don't have stability, don't have structure. They're not properly trained on how to be a human because their parents weren't. So it's like, first off, don't dip into that kid's crazy, because you're going to come out with a little bit of crazy on you. And the second thing is, if anybody touches you physically, like, you never start a fight, but you will end every fight here and ongoing physically. Like, so if a kid wants to push you or punch you, like, you better handle it now, like a batter to hell. And so, for example, like, my kid a couple of years ago, he was middle school. He's a senior now in high school. Like, he got pushed or beat up or something at the like on the way home when it's middle school. And my wife was around. So she goes down there and she's yelling at kids. I'm like, don't do that. Like, leave that alone. Let him handle that. So the kid, you know, she's yelling at him. The kid obviously is making fun. You had to get your mom. So I guess, like, a couple of days later, the next week, I obviously had a conversation with my son, like, hey, bro, kid touches you again, beat the hell out of him. So kids mess him again in the middle of, like, a classroom area. And I get a call. Hey, your son got an altercation, beat a kid up and whatever. So I call. I said, what happened? Well, the kid pushed him. And so did it. I said, great. Sounds good. Okay, I'll deal with it. Took him to ice cream. Like, it is what it is, man.
What about say, the physical is easy. I think that physical is a lot easier than the verbal, because today it's a touch and go with verbal altercations. You being half black, half white, my son, same way. By the way, my wife is half white, half black, Cuban American Indian. So our children are kids. So we're a blended. So my wife and I were a blended family. I brought three to the table. She brought one. She was a single mom, single dad, blended family. And then we had one together. And so you can't tell at all that our youngest, Jordan, he's like the lightest thing in the world. And you can't tell that he's, you know, a quarter black. So it's the weirdest thing. But how do you coach your kids, you know, with the what they face in the classroom today when it comes to verbal verbal abuse, because sometimes that's it's harder to deal with because there's no physical exchange or explosion. It's just all talk, and they can think about it all day.
I think a couple things. One is like I use big words with my kids. My wife's not a fan of it. She's like, you're talking too big of words. And I'd prefer them learn large words, because those, as an adult man, are some of the most like sharpest cutting things I can have in conversations. Like when I can verbally assault somebody in ways they can't comprehend the words, it's stupid. They feel stupid and attacked at the same time. And that's a whirlwind. So I'm like, I win every time. Right. And I'm not going to hit you nowadays unless you hit me. It's just how it's going to work. But my kids, I use big words. Secondly, I'm keen on teaching them how to be able to go back and forth without engaging too deep. Cause I let them know, like, look, you don't have to, like, this person is going to say things, do things. You and I both know it's stupid. And who cares if they think they won, like, go home. And the reason it's big for them to be able to say go home is at home, they have a base. Like, we are base at home. So therefore, if somebody says something, does something, like, they can, in the back of their head, I've seen it happen. They're like, this kid's crazy. And they come tell us. And it's like, yeah, as a unit, we're like, yeah, they're tripping. And so they have this backing behind them. So when they go to school, they may get those words or whatnot, but it's like they have the base at home to feel like, this kid's stupid. I don't know what they're talking about. And we have those conversations about those things happening. I think some kids don't have that. They get a barrage at home like that, the words at home like that. So they go to school and get it. And they start thinking, like, maybe I am that. And now it's back and forth, and they have no anchor, and they feel crazy, and it just goes to a whole different levels it shouldn't.
Key point, man. But by the way, I'm just thinking about your point there about using big words. You reminded me of Stephen A. Smith and the way he goes across debates. And
he uses too big of words. It's funny when Kevin Hart, gets on him. You ever seen Kevin Hart get on him? He's like, Stephen, you be using these damn words. You know what they mean. I'd be cryptocratic cuddle. He goes hard. And I love it. I'm not that level, but I do, like, when we're at, like, at, you know, football games, and the moms, once they get, like, super loud, I just use words that are large. And I think football taught me to be calm in heated moments. So I actually slow things down and I can stay calm. Some people are like, and I go, hey, you want to get the words out? Like, you know, you want to take a break? Like, I can mess with them in ways, because I'm calm when they're crazy. And then I use the big words. It's a weird thing I do, but I try to avoid that at all times. I don't like getting into altercations if I don't have to.
So Trux, talk to me about, you know, we're our YouTube channel. A lot of them are faith-based entrepreneur. Now, a lot of people want to make themselves a self-made millionaire, self-made, entity, obviously, with faith-led. When did God and your faith kick in to your life?
17, almost 18, I want to say. So I grew up in my family, like, we were Christians on, like, you know, Easter and Christmas. It was kind of the thing. But outside of that, we didn't do much. And I remember I was about to go off to college. And I was taking college trips to go to different schools. And I took one to Washington State. At the time, I had my high school sweetheart. We're together. So I go up there, and, you know, I have this host that's taking me around and showing me the place. And I go to this party, and the guy's, you know, hey, pick one of these girls. And I'm like, it felt uncomfortable. Out walks this guy that was from a rival high school of mine back home that I knew, that actually got me the plug to go up there. He said, hey, you want to go for a walk? I said, yeah, I feel uncomfortable. Let's go for a walk. Takes me to the top of these bleachers. Asks me a question. Are you saved? I said, no. I think about it, but faith-based says, well, you're about to step into a world as a college athlete. We're going to have a lot of time, a lot of people chasing you, a lot of fame. Like, if you don't have an anchor and a base, the world's going to take advantage of you. And not even from a stance of, like, overall, but your heart will get kind of mixed up in it. He's like, you might consider looking into faith and having an anchor there. So, okay, cool. Left it at that. 2 days later, I finally fly home. I land in the San Francisco Bay Area. I live about an hour and a half from the airport. The guy said to pick me up, because the school sets it up, has a little sign outside, and I walk up. He's an olive, you know, skin guy, got short brown hair, and it looks like Jesus. I'm dead serious, man. He probably did it on purpose. But here's the thing. I get into the van. The first thing he says when I get in, he goes, are you saved? I go, man, I'm 17, 18 years old. I'm like, that's a really weird thing to ask. I just talked to a guy just 2 days ago about this. He says, well, do you mind if I kind of share my testimony as we drive home? So I was like, yeah. So the whole ride home, he just shares the whole testimony. He's kind of giving me, like, the gospel a little bit. And so we get to about a block from my house, pulled it aside. He says, hey, do you mind if I pray with you and accept Christ into your heart? I said, yeah, man, let's do it. So if you probably walked by at that moment, it'd be weird, like this strange guy and some dude in the backseat, like, you know, eyes closed. But no, man, I prayed to Christ. And it was a catalyst of me becoming a better man, period. Like, I didn't cuss much when I was through college. I didn't cuss in the NFL much. Like, I'm still anchored. I had my window post NFL where, like, divorce took place and, you know, you spin out of control, unfortunately. Yeah. But man, that was the beginning of it. And it has been a humongous help for me, because the life after, like, I left high school did not get easier. It got more like difficult. And if I didn't have that anchor and base, I could have honestly just been cast out to the sea and been lost in the craziness of the storms.
Wow.
Talk to me about your recruitment experience. You're Antioch, right?
Antioch, California. Yeah. Live in Walnut Creek now, but grew up in Antioch.
Gotcha. By the way, is that close? How close is that to Sacramento?
I was just up there, actually. Sacramento, but it depends on where you go in Sacramento. It's about an hour away, but Sacramento has this weird length to it. But
got it.
The farthest point from me to Sacramento is like an hour and a half. Closest is about 45 to an hour.
Gotcha. Because that's where my wife played. She went to high school. She grew up in Sactown, and she played at Rancho Cordova.
Yeah,
and then, and then she got recruited by University. She's a softball girl, so she got recruited to Pitt. So where you played, you know, pro, that's where she played college.
My wife's a big softball person, too. She did a lot of softball, even like co-ed softball after college and everything. So, yeah, softball's big around here, too.
Wow, no kidding. So when you're looking at the recruiting process, because, you know, I'm in business and a lot of people are entrepreneurs, they're looking at recruiting talent. I always find it unique. Uniquely how recruiters who are offering potentially the same product. It's a college degree. You're going to play football. Yeah. What stuck out to you being recruited? You got the letters, you got the calls, you got the scouts in the stands. What stuck out to you why you got recruited to? Why Oregon, not? Why not Washington State? Why not, you know, Colorado or whoever? Who's after you?
Top five after you?
At the time, it was USC, Washington State. It was Oregon, Cal a little bit, which is weird. At that time, they didn't recruit locally for some reason. And Nebraska and Michigan were like the big ones.
Bro, big programs, man. Those are blue, the blue bloods.
Right there. Yeah, had all of it, man. It was cool. And so I go to Washington State, and I'm like, I'm going to Washington State. And then which was a dumb idea back in the day. By the time I was just like, the first time I'd seen a real college, I'm like, oh, I'm going to come up here. They told me it was warm snow. They're like, oh, it's warm snow. I was like, there's no snow. It's warm. But I bought it. I was like, they said it's warm snow. So... But no, but then I took a trip. I got home and canceled all my trips. I was like, I don't want to go to Nebraska or USC or Michigan, none of these. But then Oregon coach, who happens to be from the Bay Area, my son goes to a school called De La Salle, big football team. And he was his brother was the head coach or something. But he was like, kept recruiting me. I think he probably did it illegally, to be honest. He was calling me in the morning, at night. You got to get up to Oregon. You got to come check this place out. You don't know what you're doing. Eventually, I was like, look, all right, I'll come up there. If it'll shut you up, I'm going to take a free trip. You know, I'll go do it. I go do it. Fell in love. Here's why I fell in love. One, if you ever seen Oregon as a student athlete, that place is amazing. Like you're the pro football team out there. There's nobody in Oregon, right? Yeah. So like they wine and dine. It's beautiful. The second part was he lied to me. That's the first part. The second part, he's like, hey, if you come up, because I was a receiver and a linebacker, mostly receiver. He's like, well, if you go here, will you get a chance in training camp or not to be able to do half offense and half defense? So you get to choose what side of the ball you want to play. Oh, sign me up, right? Second, third, there was guys from the Bay there. So there was like a whole, like it was a track of a lot of guys. So when I go home in the summertime or breaks, I could go with guys who were from the home area. They knew me, right? So I went, my host was a guy named Demetrius Williams, played with the Ravens, went to De La Salle here. But like we knew similar people. We grew up, you know, probably 15, 20 minutes from each other. Mm-hmm. So it was that kind of connection. So those three things were big to me. Every college nowadays has got phenomenal stuff. Like everything, the lockers got reclining seats and TV screens and underwater pool, all that. It's all there. Right. And so for me at that time, like it was really what felt like a good fit for home.
Got it. So that was it. The environment you had to be there. You had to be immersed environment.
Yes. Heavy with the people, but everybody's different. Some guys, you know, they're going somewhere. Like I didn't really consider it. It's the worst part about it. My mom and dad, like I'm adopted. Right. So my whole family, non-athletes, fair percentage like obese, right? So I'm the only one there. My mom and dad was like, hey, you want to help with this college thing? They're like, we trust you. So I was like this 18-year-old kid figuring it all out on my own. My son right now, we know what's going on, like dialed in first track stuff. But back then I wasn't looking at, well, do they need linebackers? Do they need receivers? Is this guy, the guy recruited me was a defensive coordinator. Of course he wasn't going to put me on offensive side. I didn't know that. You know, I'm just this kid trying to figure it all out. And it was pretty much this grown man who is a recruiter, and it's pretty much he's sales. It's what they're doing. They're doing sales, selling this 18-year-old kid a dream who he's never had a dream, right? Now, it's not an advantage thing. He was giving me a great opportunity, and it has been a phenomenal opportunity. I take nothing from it. Loved my time there. But at the time, man, like he could poke the buttons of what I needed to hear and got me to go there.
I mean, looking at you, I was wanting to share my screen here, but we can't, for some reason, I can't share the screen here and show you what I'm looking at. But I'm actually on your website and a picture of your family. It looks like four or five kids and you, right? And you stick out.
Oh, you're talking about as a kid. Up in the corner there.
Yeah, in the corner. And then there you are with, I don't know, freaking Mike Tyson neck. Picture right below. What the heck were you doing, man? Are you like lifting up the entire gym?
Lifting weights. What you do as a linebacker, I had to get a bunch of, dude, seriously, I took in about 6,000 to 8,000 calories a day and just lift. That was my job. If your job is to lift weights and run around, you lift weights and run around.
How did you eat all that food when you were poor, though? What are you eating, man? Like,
That picture was from college to the NFL. So that I wasn't I wasn't in high school. I was skinny, bro. I left high school at 183, left college at 235 pounds ish. So I gained like 50, 60 pounds between getting there in high school and leaving.
I'm looking at a picture right now at Antioch across your jersey, number 82. On your jersey, you're holding the ball, you know, they love you, man. You know,
it was a blast. I'm in the Hall of Fame back home in India.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the picture. We'll make sure we put this on here. Another commonality between you and I, we both are track stars. Do you remember your distance in long jump and triple jump?
So I know my long jump was like 21.1 or something like that. And then my triple jump, I wasn't all that good at triple jump, but I want to say it was like right around 40, might have been 39.40 for the triple.
Oh man, we would have competed then, man. You and I would have been going to the
problem was my senior year. So I didn't run like sprints after my sophomore year because we had faster guys and I was just doing football. So I started getting heavy. So I'm like, as I was getting older, I was like, I'm about to like long jump, but I'm training to be a linebacker, you know? And so I was like, I was gaining weight, trying to jump was not the ideal thing to do.
I mean, it's crazy to see these athletes in the Olympics. You know, the sad part about it, the biggest ego thing for me, because I was in Okinawa, Japan. I was in the Marine Corps, best shape of my life. You know, every day in Okinawa, Japan, either you're drunk or you're working out. I chose a workout. And so best shape of my life, I'm running every day, you know, working out at night, and in addition to the Marine Corps stuff. And we went out for this run. And so I'm running, boom. And next thing you know, these guys take off like they're sprinting. I'm like, what are these guys taking off? They're sprinting for? It's a 6K. And I realized, damn, that's your pace. I'm like, I guess I'm not be number one in this race. And for about another five miles right behind me, I just kept hearing these footsteps. And it kept getting closer and closer and closer, almost to the point where I'm sprinting again. And next thing you know, I said, I can't handle this pace. I'm almost sprinting. I slow down. Next thing you know, footsteps pass me up. And all I see is a bunch of ponytails just waving right by me.
Oh, girls were catching you. Oh, dude, they were getting it, huh? Hey, my grandpa was a Marine Station Okinawa. He learned Weichiru karate. That's what I did.
Really?
Yeah.
I love it, man. Yeah, we had the martial arts out there. We learned pushing water technique, kung fu, the different styles, horse, snake, crane, all the stuff out in Japan. Yeah.
Small world.
So I want to ask you this. You know, when your book is about, you know, your identity, you know, and I want to ask you from a coach's perspective, you know, it seemed like all the conversation we've been had so far, you had to shift your identity as a young kid, dropped off, adopted. Foster care, high school, fitting in, NFL, teen parent, girlfriend come with you. There's so many different areas where you had to work, you know, get in to fit in. And you had to mold yourself and you had to be versatile in a lot of things. What's your form? Do you have a formula for that in terms of the shifts in identity you've had to create throughout your entire life? And is there a formula for shifting your identity that best serves you and the purpose you feel that's been called upon your life?
Yeah, it's definitively a process. Years ago, like I started talking about the concept and then like noticing in my life where I'd gone, because after like NFL, I went to a pretty dark bottom and then I climbed out of it. And then you're kind of just at this fog, consistent stability level. But then it's like, I want to do great things. And what I did to go from bottom, like to midway, I did the same thing to go from midway to the top, so to speak. And in hindsight, I was like, I never really looked at it and codified it. Never looked and said, where did psychology tie in? Where did like neuroscience become part of it? Where did just human logic become part of it? And so when I looked back, I was like, oh, there actually is a thread, a golden thread to what I did as a kid, you know, to go from that, you know, kid that didn't feel good about himself to getting a college scholarship and then, you know, getting the NFL and then opening businesses and all these things. And so the thread was like, there's steps I did. And the steps I did, well, the first part, which we'll just go briefly through, was like, I was able to drop the ego when I needed to. I was like, I needed to look at it and go, where am I the problem? Where am I the common denominator? And most of us don't do this. So first is like, if you can do that, you can go through the three steps. Three steps are see, shift, sustain. It's in the book. It's called the shift method. We created this process, amazing exercises that guide you through it all to transform and achieve at the same time. But the first step is to see, what is your specific thing you got to do that you don't want to look at right now? Because a lot of people, like, there's some things they got to work on, but they're busy doing work, but not work on the right things. So if you can see it, then you can actually work on it. It's a big ego to pull back, and it finds itself. And when it clarifies, now I know what to do. Then you go and do what's called the shift work.
Hold on real quick. Anthony, how do you know, how do you become self-aware that you, how do you become self-aware that you're trapped up in your ego? Because sometimes people don't realize that their ego is kicking in.
No, they don't. Well, anytime you feel like an abrasiveness or like you feel like a trigger, like people feel attacked. I got a buddy who's like, you know, me and my girlfriend have this conversation and, you know, and she said she wanted chocolate. And then I went somewhere and she, you know, she didn't actually say she wanted. She mentioned she was like, wanted. But anyways, I wanted chocolate because she said it. So I bought chocolate, ate it myself. She got mad at me. I was like, yeah. He goes, yeah, but I don't know why she got mad. She didn't say she didn't ask me to buy her chocolate. And in his head, he could not see his problem. I was like, bro, you didn't do the thing that she asked you to do. She just didn't word it a certain way, but he couldn't see it. He's like, she's illogical. And I was like, no, that's you not seeing yourself. So he had to get an outside perspective. That's kind of the thing. So part of our processes are, if you feel like there's something going on, it's usually a mark where you can go, okay, there's something odd that I can't see. Let me enlist somebody else. And so we do things to help you enlist other people to show you your life in ways that you don't see, because it is hard to see the label when you are inside of the jar. And we all live in that jar, dude. So that's the first thing, is actually enlist other people to show you who you are sometimes.
It's interesting, you know, because both my wife and I were both these alpha personalities, and she, you know, she's a softball player, shortstop, you know, she's the phenom of the team. Here I am, this Marine, I was in charge of Marines, you know, two combat deployments, and you have these two egos. Now, let me ask you this question. How does, where in the areas does ego help you?
Man, positive. It's a ton of help. My wife and I are the same way, man. Legit, the same way. She is.
We need to go to dinner, bro. We need this thing to go to dinner.
Is type A. She's dialed. I do what I want. I don't do what I don't want to do. And that becomes so much sarcastic fun for our family and my life. But we figure it out. We have our good adaptability to it. But the ego shows up to protect the identity, good and bad. So, for example, when I played football, my ego said, I'm a great football player. Therefore, the action showed up to protect that identity by going to practice, lifting weights, eating the right food, taking care of the body, right? Because I want to do the actions that can uphold the identity. So it shows up in being a great mom, a great business owner, a great spouse or partner, because that's who I am. So it shows up positively. The problem is, it'll also protect just as easily the parts of you that need to be upgraded, right? Maybe you don't communicate well. Maybe you're a little bit, I don't know, maybe you talk too much. Maybe, you know, you don't admit fault and don't apologize often. That's part of your identity still. Like, oh, I'm good. You're wrong. Like, you know, that shows up. And so while it protects the good, it also protects the bad. But you got to see what is going on there so you can actually start to let some of these things stop being protected so they can be improved.
Amazing. What are the other two parts?
The other part's shift, which is the work. We all know we got to work. I tell people, and this is clear, action ends suffering. Straightforward, man. No matter what we're suffering with in some capacity, we're not going to feel like doing something, but that's the moment you must do something. And if you don't, you just prolong the pain. So some action in some direction is what will solve the problem. Most of the time, people have a pain, this thing going on, but the actions they take, they didn't see the right ones. They're taking ones that are not doing anything for them. So they end up being tired and burnt out and no better than they were to begin with. But so you got to take an actual look at what you got to work on, craft a plan that allow you to work on your specific things, and then get to work. It's pretty straightforward. The last piece is the one where it's the most critical, because an identity shift doesn't take place because you choose to. You can change perspectives, but who you are takes time to change. And so most people don't sustain. See, shift, sustain. What it looks like, it's kind of the thing where the actions you're going to take are going to feel way out of character naturally, because the character of the person that has the money you want, the house you want, it's not who you are right now. So those things will feel awkward. And so what I tell people, it's kind of like when you go to the coffee shop, right? You go to the coffee shop, I got to get some work done. But you're scrolling through your phone, you're ticking away, and you go, ah, I got to focus. So I sit down, I focus. In the first minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, maybe 10 minutes, it's like I'm actively trying to focus. And all of a sudden, 3 hours goes by. You're like, whoa, I got everything done. I feel good. Man, it's all, whoa, okay. Mm-hmm. Same thing happens for an identity shift, right? I saw some stuff. I know what to work on. Now I get to work day one. I feel it day two. I feel it day three, you know, day four, week two, week three. All of a sudden it drowns out. 3 months goes by. I lost weight. My marriage is good. My business is running smooth. Like, holy crap. I can't even put myself in the head of the experience of how that guy saw things and operated and processed and handled situations. It's at that moment you go, ooh, I feel like a new person. And that's how a shift takes place.
Man, powerful, powerful stuff. When we're coaching new entrepreneurs, when we're coaching people that are making $25,000 a year to make $50,000 a year, $50,000 a year to jump up to $7,500,000 to become, obviously our YouTube channel, Seven Figure Squad, to become a millionaire, to have a seven-figure type cash flow type income, obviously there's a shift in identity.
Huge.
My observation, you know, coaching entrepreneurs is some guys, man, I want to do big things. They cap out $100,000 or they cap out at 80 grand, they cap out at $900,000 and they never make more than that next echelon. If they want to get to the next echelon, next level of their, at least from an income standpoint, what type of shifts in identity do you think must take place?
Well, the first thing is it's different for everybody. Just be completely honest. They're similar for a person at that level, but for the most part, they're different based on what you do. Because some people are like, I got to be hands-on. So I'm the bottleneck, right? My identity is attached to I'm self-made. So I don't hire people. I don't delegate. I don't outsource. I don't systemize. So I'm used to going fly by night. So some people will be stuck where they're at as long as they're holding the reins, to be quite honest. On top of that, some people still have this inherent piece of them that almost like I find people that are afraid of success because they don't know if they can handle the success. Like, I'm like, I don't want to get it and then lose it. So I don't want to get it, right? So people won't do the work. On top of that, sometimes the things they got to work on, people will tell them, I'm sure there are people that you've interacted with, you've told them what to do, but they don't want to listen because it's not who I am to do that, right? It's a big piece of it. And then here's where everyone, no matter who they are, will feel this experience. So going from that, it doesn't matter, 1,000, 2,000 a day, whatever it is, you'll find that at some point, there'll be something asked of you. And you'll show up to that moment and you'll have this inherent, like, weird pull to not do it. It'll feel awkward. It'll feel weird. This is what I call an identity wall. Everybody you probably coach they get very similar information. They know what to do. This is not a world we live in where there's a shortage of information of what you got to do. We're aware of it. But a moment pops up and they've already cast a vision. I want to have $1 million. Beautiful. Great. So they get to a point in time where they'll make an excuse. Oh, it's been a long day. Wife and I are acting up, you know, just some argument. The kids are doing this. I got to go here, whatever it is. And I always ask people, I say, okay, great. Let me ask you a question. You know what to do, right? Yeah. Not being done, right? Yeah. Okay. The person who has what you want, would they make the same excuse to stop right now? So that separation, it's not the info. We have shelf esteem that we consume, but nobody applies. And so for those people, most of the time, it's like when you get to that moment, you've now found an identity wall. Ask yourself, what is stopping me? Like, why in the world can I climb it? Here's a simple example. I'll be quick. I got a client who I'm working through a simple process we call an ABC list. He's at that struggling point of like, I got to pull. I'm like, here, you got a good database. Do this. Have an A, B, and a C list. A list, people who are your ambassadors. B list, people who know what you do, but haven't bought into or engaged what you do, haven't invested. C list is people who have no idea what you do. Talk to the A's to get C's, turn C's to B's, B's to A's. Simple. We've been going at this for the last 3 weeks and he cannot make a phone call. Like,
wow, really?
Right? And it's simple. I told him what to say at each level. This is the simplest it gets. Now, love the guy. Great heart. Nothing. I'm not taking anything from it, but he has met an identity wall. And I tell him the separation between you and all that money you talk about, you're now looking at it. So we got to figure out what that wall is. But that is the separation for most people, just in different ways and different levels.
So now they got to climb it and use that formula you talked about to bust through it.
But when he does, I think he might've made the first call to
come on, baby. Let's do it, man.
Might've gotten, I think the message, I haven't checked the message. I saw, you know, it's the little red part and it looked like it said the guy's 90% in, he has to talk to his wife, but he's dead on. And I'm like, beautiful. Right. So I'll be able to share with him and go, look, you know, this feeling you have, like the person's on. Yeah. You have missed out on having that for the last 4 weeks. Imagine if that 4 weeks, you know, passed by with more calls, more momentum, how much farther ahead you'd be now. Yep. And so where some guys are probably saying like, oh, I'd make the calls and sure you would, but there is still something you are not doing that you could do that move you faster. That's your wall to find though.
For those of you watching this, put in the comment section below, I am busting through my wall. I am busting through my wall. And I just want to, for those of you at that wall, you're not the only one. So what's your biggest frustration or, like, you know, your kind of SMH type moment when you see people that have so much potential and they never realize it?
Man, yeah. So years ago, I found someone told me a simple statement. They said, you cannot want more for someone than you want for, than they want for themselves. So people have this inherent level to be where they're at. And it's like, we struggle to get them to go past them. Like, I could see what you can do. You could do so damn much. Why don't you? And what I found is, like, my frustration is that they just don't see themselves the way I do. Because as much as we may not see our faults, a lot of us just don't see our powers. And so for me, in those moments, I try to realize that typically when I'm frustrated like that, it's because I know, because I'm close to him. And you can actually be too close. So when I get to that point, the reality is I feel like you're robbing the world of a gift of you. There's something great you can do, there's something powerful, and the world can benefit. But man, you're robbing the world of it, because who knows what, right? And you won't listen to me. So what I do is I plant seeds and I introduce them to people that could inspire them, that can water that seed. And that's how I get past the frustration. But I also realize, like, I'm trying to swim to the top of the ocean, man. And I can't hang on, you know, to this dead weight while still swimming to the top. So not that I let people go, but I'm like, hey, bro, if you want to drop the weight you're holding on to, we could both swim faster. But if not, I'm gonna let you go, man. So I'm well aware of what goes on. I have the conversation, but it's always gonna be frustrating because you'll always find those people.
When you got hurt and you had that injury, you realized it was a career ending injury, and a good chunk of your life at that point has already been devoted to the sport. You know, the weekends, the workouts, the all the stuff you talked about at the beginning of this conversation, all the preparation, all the commitment, your life. And now you're no longer a football player. And NFL players and pro players, I see go through the same thing I see my brothers and sisters go through in the military, where so much of their identity was wearing the uniform, was being a Marine. You know, you're in charge of Marines. And now you're nobody. When usually when you're in the military, you get into a room, everybody's standing up and saluting you, and now you're just Joe Schmo going to Walmart. How is that identity shift from you saying you're no longer a pro football player, now you got to create the rest of them? Not for long, NFL, yeah.
Well, the shift didn't take place till the crisis took place, right? Because you have an identity crisis, and then you're like, ah. And some people stay in that for the rest of their lives, unfortunately. You know, with Napoleon Dynamite's uncle never got out of that. Like, I could have been in state if I, you know, just stick with it forever, right? So what I found is that
you got my staff laughing over you, man.
It's true, though. Hey, it is so, it's just common. It's funny because it's true, right? It's in the movie because there's an uncle that does that. This is just legit. But here's the truth, though. We all go through these moments where we have this fruit of our labor, right? That's your identity. It's the apple in the tree, and the apple falls off the tree and it rolls in the ground. And now while the apple can hang for a bit, you know, eventually it can go to the store and go to your house, but it'll eventually rot. And we feel that way. I can hang for a year after the NFL is out, but 2 years after, it's like, damn, who am I without this game? I send a kid to college. Who am I without driving my kids around to school or going to different practices? Who am I when I sold the business? I'm just sitting here with money. Who am I, right? Yeah. And what happens is we never comprehend that we've never been the fruit. We've always been the tree.
Wow.
We can go back and start taking care of the tree. We start to realize, like, it produces better and sweeter fruit when you prune it and you water and all that stuff. When you're focused on one fruit, you don't focus on the rest. Those ones all die too, man. And the tree dies. So the idea is, like, realize that you're not the fruit. When I take care of the tree, I'm going to produce something way better. Like, my life now is better than NFL could have provided. The what I get to do, how I get to be present, I can make money without beating my body up. Like, I'm in a better place internally. It just took me 6 years to figure that out, unfortunately. I try to shortcut that process for most people.
Gotcha. I mean, it's not like you had such multi-million dollar signing contracts in your career. Yeah. I mean, what was the biggest, if you care to share?
I think the most I had, my league minimum was like, at the time, was like $400,000 a year.
What?
Yeah, it wasn't huge, right? And I think my last check in the NFL, they took like $55,000 in taxes or something. I don't even remember what the check was. But yeah, I might have made $1 million through my years playing in the league. I think that was what it turned out to be. So yeah. Again, like, save my body. Make more now.
Yeah. And in California, you may go through $1 million just like that. And it's just
we just bought a house, and money is like, yeah, you look at the same house in Texas, it's like, geez, this would have been like $200,000 in Texas. Out here, it's $1 million+ easily. It's just, it's how it works. But yeah, money is this thing where everybody's like, there's only one way to get it. I'm like, no. The things I learned in football make me money now.
Yeah. I also realize you also have twins.
I do have twins.
I got twins. It's a way to stay, man. My twins are, how old are you? You have a boy and a girl? The twins?
A girl, 12 years old.
Wow. I have two girls that are 20, man. And so I'm just curious, as a fellow father of twins, you know, for me, when I did, I've learned as a father of twins, I've learned to discipline them separately. Because they always stand up for each other, and they, as they should, they stick up for each other. Even though I'm yelling at both of them, and so what has been?
We don't get that. Well, we have fraternal, a boy and a girl, and one's like you said. My son is light; he looks Puerto Rican like his mom, and my daughter black, definitely like me. And so there is a difference, but they don't stand up for each other the same. They definitely cause their own little havoc and turmoil. But there's Stephen Covey statement. He says, "Treat everyone the same by treating everyone different." So like, I treat them similarly by treating them different based on what their individual needs are.
Who's been in your ear, Trucks, to help you grow as an individual, as a person, as an entrepreneur? Do you invest heavily in other coaches and consultants? Because, you know, you're spitting game that I don't hear a lot of NFL players getting out of the league talk about, even if they had, you know, years and years and years under the belt, you know, under contracts.
Yeah, it's just, man, life experience. I have a great circle of friends. I am right now away from what's a 3-day event in Napa with an incredible room of people. I don't know if you know our space, but like Brendon Burchard's there, Dean Graciosi's there, Lewis House, Clint Shelton, Princier, Jay Shetty, Dave Hollis, Heidi Powell. It's the list keeps going on. Marie Folio, Maria Nunez, like all these amazing people are there literally right now. I might have to miss dinner because we're in the process of moving, but we've been the last couple of days. So one is I'm around great minds. And I let them challenge me. Like I'm open to feedback. I'm not that guy, you know, who's just like, I'm the greatest. Started that way, but now I'm open to it. And I realize the things they share to help me be better. It's not to attack me. And they're open. They've gone through the same journey themselves. So I have it modeled for me. But I learn from life. I think we live lives every day. They're amazing classes. But then we end up leaving class and we don't pass the test later wondering why. You didn't stay in class. So that hard conversation with your kid or the argument with your wife or, you know, issue with business. These are all moments that we can learn from if we can bury the ego for 5 minutes and open the mind and go, am I wrong? Did I do something? Did I mess up here? So I try to pay attention to life. And that's a huge gain for me. It's a great, it's a book called, you ever read Outwitting the Devil?
Of course, Napoleon Hill. Don't be a drifter. That's my favorite part.
Don't be a drifter, right? He also at the end talks about wisdom and experience. Yeah. And experience and information, intellectual stuff, it's great, but it's not wisdom because wisdom must be seasoned. And so for me, I started looking at life experiences and getting the information, intellectual aspect, but letting it season over time. So I think just for me, I just have paid attention longer to life than most people. Therefore, it looks like, oh, he's an old soul. Like, no, I'm not that old. I just paid attention. Most people don't pay attention until 40, 50. I just did it at 20.
You know, the interesting thing about your circle, I'm thinking about all these guys, because they're all influencers. They all have a public persona. They all coach people in how to have better lives. And I'm thinking about my industry, the insurance industry. You have these insurance sales reps and executives have been around for forever, and they don't want to see other people grow in their space. So we've had to create a company. So we had to create a company that recruited another generation to say, if the older generation doesn't hand over the torch, we're just going to earn our torch because eventually they're going to have to pass it on. And instead of demanding it, you know, I think inherently we're just shifting the identity of even the insurance industry, because insurance agents don't look like my face. And there was more of us like this. Let me ask you this question. What's going on in America today, back half of this interview, the crazy thing that's going on in America today, how do you see this country that has allowed you so much opportunity, has allowed you so much prosperity and many different ways for you to go from adopted kid to now this, you know, this entrepreneur, this author, this international speaker? How do you feel about capitalism and entrepreneurship and what America is today?
It's still the greatest country in the world. I think there's this incoherent babble that goes on in the world. And I don't take sides. I just take a look at my life. It's all I can do, right? So for me, I was given not a lot of opportunity and I created something. Now it's funny because everyone's given the same stuff informationally early. Work hard in school, like pay attention to stuff, learn to do things, take risks, you know, try new things out, stay consistent, be honorable, have integrity. These are basic things that aren't practiced in life. And then what happens is, we tell people, you know, save for rainy day, you're going to need it. And then here's where I think the issue is. There are individuals who listened. Like myself, I paid attention. I fought really hard to be this guy, to build this freedom, this control of my life that I have. And then when the moment comes in life where I feel like, hey, I'm prepared for this, you know, everything's good. But those people that weren't prepared, like it sucks, but like, hopefully this moment, it's hard enough for them to realize to wisen up, maybe teach their kids different or prepare themselves better, learn more. The world's come out and it gives them a handout that hurts them. I think, in my opinion, there's a lot of handouts that have diminished people's ability to feed themselves in the future. We're given fish, not taught how to fish. And so because of that, the individuals who are being fed by this, you know, we'll call it the big machine, they then go in with the argument and battle on their side of like, it should be easy, it should help, we should X, Y, Z. And then it makes the country look weak, and it makes everybody look like we're soft because we're all like looking for handouts. And I think capitalism of itself is like, you're going to go in and create, you're going to pretty much catch what you kill, but you got to learn to kill, right? So how are we going to be this great, amazing country that gives us, I mean, capitalism creates freedom, creates competition, that creates ingenuity and creates, you know, new ideas and new growth. And look at all the countries that we have. There's one country that amasses like the best technology for phones and the social media, all these things. Why is that? Because we all had competition and we had to compete and had to make new things. So that is what's made the world better. So why are we diminishing that and not allowing people to go do that? It's just super weird. So I'm not a fan of where I feel like the energy of the country is moving, but it doesn't deter me from doing what I do. Because the only way that we do continue to have as countries for people to still stand up and do things the right way, even if the rest of the world doesn't want to.
My mentor, Patrick McDavid, he hosts a channel called Valuetainment. And he interviewed a communist today. And he's a professor at Riverside City College. And he was asking him today, this morning, they launched the episode. He says, what do you think has brought more to society? Who do you think would bring more impact to society? Jeff Bezos or Stalin? You know what this guy said? Huh. Stalin.
Really?
What? And you're a college professor?
It's an identity thing. That's the problem with that. I think another part of it is people are anchored in their identities. And so to say anything opposite would make them think they diminish all of who they are. Logic wouldn't tell you that. Look at what's come out of those countries and then ours. It's night and day. You can't even argue with logic, right? But it's who he is. God forbid he misaligns with who he is and the people that see him a certain way. So you're also asking imperfect humans to make, you know, pretty much statements that would have them be out of alignment with their, you know, here's a funny thing. People say, I'm not perfect. But the moment you show them an area of imperfection, they fight it. It's a very weird societal thing. But yeah, no, that's you have people do that kind of stuff. And I'm like, you know, that's stupid. I'm sitting here talking, like, that's a wrong idea. But I'm going to go ahead and base on the fact that if you did say opposite, it would diminish who you are. I have friends, for example, all the stuff spun up and with the racial stuff at the time. And if you look at our world, just take a 50,000 foot view, who's in control and power? It's typically not looking like me. So that should tell you there's some kind of what used to be systematic is now a systemic issue. But there are people in certain career positions where I'm like, hey, this is what's going on. And they go, no, it couldn't be the case. It's all like Lily said that everyone's given the same ability to do X, Y, Z and climb to the top. There's no such thing as systemic racism. And it ends up being like a police officer. I'm like, but I get it. Because if you were to go in line with that, that would diminish who you see yourself to be as an officer. So I don't hate you as a person. No, none of that. Like I get from a bigger standpoint where you have to stand. Because if not, you go to bed and you can't sleep.
You know, it's funny that you just mentioned that. You know, I did have a conversation with my son, who at that time was 9. He's now 10. He's about to be 11 this weekend. I'm having a conversation with him about how to comply with when these days he comes across the police and how the world looks at him and how that identity with what's going on in the world today. How do you coach and guide your children in that conversation? Because it's much more magnified today, I think, more than any other time when I was growing. And I went through the Marines, and it was the Rodney King riots in L.A. I was stationed out there. So what are your thoughts?
Yeah, man, I got a son who's, you know, almost 17 this year. He'll be going off to college, and it's scary to put him in the world. But it's not scary because of the people you see in the news, because let's be honest, it's a small subset that sells newspapers. And I don't think the entire world's like that, but that does exist. And I'm real big on telling my son two things. One, don't put yourself in those situations. You know what's right and wrong. I've taught you right and wrong. Do what's right, even if it feels difficult and there's peer pressure. I've watched him exercise that, which is beautiful. Two, use your intellect. In a conversation, use words that make it appear you're not a threat. At the same time, just comply. We'll handle stuff later. I'd much rather have a court, you know, conversation than a funeral. Like I'm not doing all that. So just secede. Don't let your ego get in the way and do stupid stuff. And so for that, it's like, that's the best I can do. I've raised him in a way to where I feel confident putting him out there, but the rest of the world's going to do the rest of the world. And so for me, I literally put it on God because the most I can do. At certain points, like, it's out of my hands. And at the same time, man, it's one of those things where, like, I need him to be aware of the world. So we do point things out. One of the blessings, I think, for me growing up in an all-white family, with blessings, there's definitely a ton of curses there too, don't get me wrong. But one of the blessings was when things took place in a world, it wasn't shown to me through an angry, you know, grandma or grandpa who went through, you know, different situations in the past, who has this anger seeping through that gives me a perspective of how every white man's bad, and, you know, all that. Mm-hmm. Not everybody does that, but there's a little bit of tinge of it in some aspects and conversations I have. But I was able to see things through a different filter. So I see the world differently. I try to teach my son that, one, everyone's not like this. Those who are like that, to be quite honest, they're not usually happy people. Because to be honest, I've never seen a joyous, happy person go out and sling racial slurs. I've never seen it. They just want to be happy, right? So I'm like, realize those people are in tough places. You don't got to take the gift they're trying to give you. And if they can't give you the gift, they got to take it with themselves and walk away. So I teach them how to have conversations and be aware of it. But we have had these convos a lot.
How does it make you feel when you see these social media videos? You're watching it, you're seeing the, and people are arguing with the cops. And you're kind of like in a movie, like, yo, just, you know, I mean, they're arguing with the cops. They're trying to be right. I ain't got to show you my ID. I ain't got to get it. And they're arguing with the cops.
It's a tough precedence, because the funny thing is most of those videos, you don't get to see the person's face. It's just the video facing the police officer. So you don't know what they look like. I don't know how they're dressed. I don't know what ethnicity they were. I know nothing. I just know they're spitting off some things. And to be quite honest, like, there are things that I hear people say that I for sure know I would never say, because I wouldn't make it out of there alive. Let's just be honest. So they're just not going to happen. Mm-hmm. And whether or not it's right or wrong, I don't want to get myself in a conversation. I have to argue if it's right or wrong. I just comply. I don't do things that put me close to that. If for some reason I get, you know, pulled off of an area where I was doing nothing wrong, comply. The odds, the slim odds of me having something detrimental happen while complying are vastly better than the odds of me doing something and hopefully getting out with a cool story I get to tell about how I beat the cops. Like, that's just, it's not worth it, man. Because they're also talking about imperfect emotional humans who are in a very, very tense world right now, who are getting a barrage of hate, and you might be the punching bag that day.
Yeah. I tell all my military buddies are cops these days, man. It's hard to have a job when you can't have a bad day. And when you have a bad day, everybody knows about it.
True. Tough.
What would you say to our faith-based community? Because some of the biggest comments I get, you know, when I'm talking about being a faith-based millionaire, right then and there, should not be even going in the same phrase.
Right. Yeah, it's harder to get a man into heaven as it is to get a man into the eye of a needle, right? Yeah.
Right, right. You know, the love of money, da, 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 all these stuff. But at the same time, too, based on the goals and dreams and the jobs we want to create and the lifestyle we want to live, you kind of, quite frankly, you got to make a lot of money in this day and age, you know? Mm-hmm. So what's your guidance and advice to our faith-based community out there to, hey, it's okay to make money and it's okay to have big goals and dreams. Don't lessen. Mm-mm. What are your thoughts on that?
Something I read by, maybe it was Mark Manson, talked about, like, you should never make people the means to an end, right? You should make people the end, and the means should be different, right? The means could be money, means could be time to get to the end of doing great for people, but don't make people the means. Don't know this person to get that connection, right? So I put that out in front to say, essentially, God didn't say don't make money. He did say go prosper, be wealthy, right? But it's a matter of what are you doing to get that to the end? What are the means to get to the end? And so I found that there's a great book by Lynn Twist, and it says, it's about, called The Soul of Money. And the way she frames it in the conversation I was having with somebody else, like, kind of like this thing where it's a facilitator. And if there is a dollar out there and that dollar could be used to buy, you know, a trafficked kid or to save a kid from trafficking, well, that dollar is going to go to the person fighting for it. And if you don't fight for it because you don't believe it's, you know, it's right to have money, when it happens, that dollar is going to kind of naturally drift to the wrong side. So when I look at what I do, someone posed a question because I was like, I don't have any money goals. You're like, well, can you make money? Yeah. What would you do if you made the money? I said, I give a good chunk to, like, organizations. I donate time. I donate money. They said, okay, well, if you do good things with the money and you can make the money and you don't, you're being selfish. I was like, interesting. But, like, because at the end of the day, if you will do good things, it's up to you to get that dollar from the wrong hands and do the good thing with the dollar. Money's a facilitator. So, yes, the love of money and only money is a problem. But if you love the people and they are the end and that's a means, it's the right thing to do.
Yeah, fantastic, man. Do you have any particular favorite scriptures that you seem to always be anchored upon in reference to in your moments of either inspiration or desperation?
It's always one. And it's one that it's always, it's John 16:33. And God says, in this world, you will find trouble. Something like that. It says, like, I'm not perfect on it because I've read it in a bunch of different framings, but it's like, in this world, you will find trouble. But take heart. What does it say? Take heart. I have overcome the world. It's pretty much the ending of it. I'm missing a line there, but it's one of the scriptures I'd love to go back to. I feel like I should look it up so I don't butcher it. But it's essentially God saying, look, it's what he says. In this world, you will find trouble. I've told you that in this world, but don't freak out. Take heed. I have overcome the world. And essentially what he's saying, it's like, and mostly readers like, oh, so God overcame the world. Well, what does that do, right? We all talk about having a great relationship. So he's not saying the world's going to be easy. He's saying the world's going to be difficult. There will be hardship. It's all going to exist. But take heart, because I have overcome it. And so when we talk about accepting Christ into your heart, he now lives in you. So he's overcome the world. So if he's in you, he's got you. So for me, it's always been this conversation like, how do I keep him in me? So as I approach the world, I'm not approaching it alone.
Amen, bro. Listen, man, I can go on and on with this conversation. So many commonality between you and I, families. Obviously, you're the smarter, studlier between the two of us. But but not, by the way, not bad, man. 225 at the combine, 225, 22 times. Not bad, bro.
I thought it was more than that. That sucks. 22 wasn't that much, but it was more. It was a good morning. There you go. I'll take it. I'll take 22. Why not, man?
Take 22. Shoot, man. It's something always to work out to have goals. But with that being said, where can more people find information about you, and where can they connect with you, Anthony Trucks?
Man, fastest place is Instagram at Anthony Trucks. I got a new book out. You can go to identityshiftbook.com and you can go grab that. It's a code. It's called Book Bonus. You'll actually get some free, you know, audiobook, digital book, workbook after you buy the book. Yeah. But yeah, it's the best place, man. I share and hang out on Instagram primarily too.
Can I do this, Anthony? Can I do this? Can I buy 25 of your books? Can I buy 25 of your books and I want you to autograph it?
I'll do all of them. Yeah. That's actually going on right now. I just got a shipment in. I got a whole bunch of autographs to do. You're happy to do it. Yeah.
So for the first 25 people that comment below, the biggest takeaway from this conversation, you're going to get a book signed by Anthony Trucks, autograph as a gift from the Seven Figure Squad, from us to you in your office. So make sure you're the first to comment below your biggest takeaway from Anthony Trucks here on this interview, Seven Figure Squad. So Anthony, I appreciate your time, your attention to this, you're pulling away from such a great company that you're with, and congratulations on new home, regards to your family, your wife. And for those of you watching this on Facebook, what's your greatest takeaway? What are your thoughts on the identity shift you have to take at different stages of your life? Let me know your thoughts, comments, feedback, questions, follow up. You agree, you don't agree, put it in the comment section below. If you're watching this on Facebook, make sure you click like and follow our Facebook business page, Money Smart Guy. And if you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you click subscribe and hit notifications to be alerted the next time we upload our next episode. So on behalf of my guest today, Anthony Trucks, I'm your Money Smart Guy. And until we meet again, continue to live smart. Continue to love smart and be money smart today.